It's Miss Kate back again with another fun STEAM experiment for you. And this week, we are going to be talking about habitats and where animals live and how they adapt to their different habitats. So before we begin, we have to talk about what is a habitat. And a habitat is a place that an animal lives, and it provides the animal with food, water, shelter, and space. Those are the main four components that make a great habitat for an animal. And there are all different types of habitats all around the world, from forests to grasslands to mountains to slopes to deserts. Today we're going to talk about five main habitats. So starting off, let's talk about our first habitat, and that is our aquatic habitats. And that's going to be your seas, oceans, rivers, lakes, wetlands, marshes, lagoons, swamps, anywhere that animals live around or in a large body of water. Next, we're going to talk about deserts. And deserts are areas or landscapes that have a scarce amount of precipitation. And some of them are those really, really hot, sun-baked, sandy areas that experience high daytime temperatures, while others are actually going to be cold and have those really chilly winter seasons, but they're not going to have any type of precipitation, so they do qualify as a desert also. Next main habitat we're going to talk about is forests. And forests and woodlands are habitats that are dominated mostly by trees. And forests actually extend to over one third of the world's land surface, and they can be found all over the globe. So think about places like the rainforest, or we even have forests in like our parks. And maybe in your backyards. Next main habitat we're going to talk about is the grasslands. And grasslands are habitats that are dominated by grasses and actually have very few really large trees or shrubs. It's mostly just grassy plains. And there are two types of grasslands, and that is the tropical grasslands that are kind of like the savannas, if you know where they are, or the temperate grasslands. And grasslands actually make up a lot of the Midwest. And so that's those long fields of plain that have those grassy areas. Last habitat we're going to talk about is a tundra, and tundra is a really, really cold habitat. So it has really, really low temperatures and has a short period for vegetation, has really long winters, and it kind of has that brief growing period, and special animals have to live there because they have to be able to survive the really, really cold. Alrighty guys, so for our first experiment today, we're actually going to be focusing on tundras. And just like I said, tundras are a really, really cold habitat. So animals that live in a tundra must be able to adapt to this very, very cold temperatures. So let's start off by thinking about what are some animals that live in a tundra. You got your polar bear, your penguins, your Arctic foxes, your snow bunnies, some caribou. All those animals that live there are able to adapt to those really, really cold temperatures. So you're gonna find very few reptiles or amphibians that live in a tundra. All the animals that do live there find ways to stay warm and provide nourishment for themselves in order to survive those really long cold winter months. Now there are two ways that animals adapt to these conditions. There are behavioral adaptions and there are physical adaptions. Behavioral adaption would be like migration. So an animal might live in a tundra during its summer months, but then might move away for the really cold winter months, but then move back again during the summer months. Another behavioral adaptation would be hibernation in these really cold months. And that's what we see a lot of bears do during this time. So even though hibernation is a behavioral adaptation, a lot of times they're accompanied by a physical adaptation. Now, physical adaptation is when an animal physically changes itself to adapt to its conditions. So this could be growing an extra coat of fur or a second layer of feathers to help keep it warm, or even putting on more weight. A lot of these animals during the wintertime put on an extra layer of fat that is called blubber. And blubber is extra weight that helps keep the animal insulated and warm, and also provides nourishment and energy to help keep the animal alive during those really harsh conditions. So for our first experiment today, what we're gonna be doing is we're gonna be doing a blubber experiment. So what I have here is a glass container that contains some really cold ice water. And what I'm gonna do is I have two Ziploc bags here. One is an empty one, and another one has another Ziploc bag in it that contains some Crisco shortening. And shortening is a fat, so that's gonna represent our blubber. And our bags are gonna represent our skin. So what we're gonna do is go ahead and put your hand in one bag, and then in the other, put your hand in the other. And I did double layer these bags so that way I don't get my hand super covered in shortening. So you can see here, it's not covered. It has another layer of a bag in it. So I got my bags on both my hands, and what you're gonna do now is you're going to rest it into the cold water for a minute, and you'll feel a difference between each hand. And at the end of the minute, you wanna see which hand stays warmer. So go ahead and put on your bags and put them into the water and see which hand is colder at the end of the minute. Alrighty, so it's been a minute and I've left my hand in the ice water and I'm taking it out and setting them down. And you can even see in my hand that this one's so much redder because it's really cold. So this hand stayed kind of nice and toasty. It was a little cold, but not too cold. And this hand got really cold in the ice water. So how this experiment works is shortening is a fat that isolates the cold. And what it does is it helps keeps the warm in and the cold out. So the shortening is really dense, right? So it has a low thermal conductivity relative to the water compared to our bag that didn't have any in it. So fat that is put on by animals helps keeps the animals' insides nice and warm. For this next activity, we're gonna be talking about an aquatic habitat. And there are lots of different types of aquatic habitats, but for this one, we're gonna be talking about the biggest one, and that is the ocean. Now the ocean has three zones to it. That is the sunlight zone, the twilight zone, and the midnight zone. Now all of these zones have different accesses to resources and affect what type of ocean animals live there. So what I have here for this activity is I took three different colored pieces of paper and I made them into our different zones. So let's talk about the first layer of zone, and that is our sunlight zone. And it is the shallowest zone and is the closest to the surface of the water. And it has the most access to the sunlight. That's why it's called the sunlight zone. Because of this, it houses and produces a lot of animals and plants that need sunlight to survive. Next, we're gonna talk about the twilight zone. It's the nice in-between zone between the sunlight zone and the midnight zone. And it's a little bit thicker than the sunlight zone, but not very much, and it's not as thick as the midnight zone. Now this zone has access to sunlight, but it doesn't have access to direct sunlight like the top layer does. And because of this, animals and plants that need direct sunlight to survive don't live down here. Zone, and this is our deepest layer of the ocean, and it is the furthest from our surface of the water. Animals that live down here have adapted in many ways. They've adapted to living underneath super high water pressure, so because all that water pressure that's on the top of it has to sit on over the bottom of the ocean, so they have adapted to that high water pressure, and they've also adapted to having no sunlight, and they also eat things that are not like plants that live at the top. So they're different types of plants and sometimes microorganisms and stuff like that. So next, for this activity, what you're gonna wanna do is you're gonna make your very own diagram of the three layers of the ocean, and then you're also gonna wanna print out, or you can draw or color your own sea animals that would live at the three different layers. So I have my animals printed out here, and I'm just gonna go through each one of them and then put them in the correct layer that they live. So starting off, I have here is a sea turtle, and sea turtles, they actually come up onto the surface to lay their eggs. So they require some sunlight, and they also require access to the surface. So I'm gonna put him at the very top in our sunlight zone. Next I have here is a swordfish. Now swordfish, they don't require too many like plants to live off of, so they can kind of go in between. They don't really need a ton of direct sunlight, but they also aren't adapted to live in the really bottom. So I'm gonna put him in my middle zone, my twilight zone. Next I have here some seaweed, and seaweed is a plant, so it needs access to sunlight. So he's gonna go in my sunlight zone. My next animal is one of my favorite animals, and that is a blobfish. I have here a blobfish, and if you know anything about a blobfish, is that it's kind of its blob shape because it lives underneath high water pressure, and that is because it's gonna live in the midnight zone. So he's gonna go down there. Next, I have here some shrimp. And now shrimp, they kind of go in between the top and the middle zone because we fish for them, right? So they're kind of in between. But the middle zone fish, is it doesn't require to live off of any plants, and it doesn't technically need sunlight to live, so he's gonna go into our middle twilight zone. The next animal I have here is my giant squid, and my giant squid is gonna need lots of space, and he doesn't like direct sunlight, so he is actually gonna go down into my bottom zone. He's gonna go in my midnight zone. Next, I have a shark. And now this one's kind of tricky because he can either go in our top zone or our middle zone. But sharks don't really like to go up too high in the sunlight. They kind of like the colder temperatures, so they kind of like to be lower. So my shark is gonna go in my middle zone. So I have two more ocean animals left. And my next one is gonna be an angular fish. And this fish is really unique because it has adapted and has its very own light kind of antenna. So any guesses on maybe where he'll go is where he'll need his light. Yeah, so he's gonna go into my midnight zone because he's adapted to living in those dark conditions because he has his own little light over him. And my last animal I have here is our friendly dolphin. And if you've ever been to Florida or near an ocean, sometimes on the horizon, you can see dolphins coming up to play. So he likes our sunlight and he's gonna come up in our sunlight zone. So here we have our finished diagram of our different layers of the ocean that we have filled with the different animals that live in each of its layer. And it kind of has its own unique habitats within one big habitat. Alrighty guys, well I hope you had fun with today's experiment and activity and I hope you look into more about habitats. They're really interesting and really cool. Maybe see where your favorite animal's habitat is. So if your favorite animal is like a panda bear, maybe learn more about forests and the different types of forests that your favorite animal lives in. You can also make really fun dioramas with habitats or maybe even just researching about different animals that live in a certain habitat or even if you have a habitat behind your house. Thanks again for watching this video and I hope you had fun with these activities. I hope to see you again soon. Thanks, bye.